Collaboration is the Future of Healthcare, Chile-U.S. Nursing Exchange. I'm Melissa Sutherland. I know we met earlier. I am at Boston College. I am a nurse as well as a family nurse practitioner, and I share that because that will become a little it's important for some of the things I'll be doing at Catolica this semester. As you can see, I am at Catolica at the San Joaquin campus. In addition, my work as a nurse practitioner and an RN have been in community and public health, so those are kind of my areas of clinical expertise. I'm also a researcher, and my area of research has focused on intimate partner violence and the health consequences of intimate partner violence, specifically on sexually transmitted infection and HIV risk. So that's what my research has focused on. Just recently finishing up a National Institutes of Health grant, and so this was kind of a perfect time to come to Chile and do some work at Catolica. So just a little background information. Healthcare systems in Chile and the U.S. share common characteristics. They have an established infrastructure to provide high-quality medical care. There's a commitment to education, preparing the health professionals of the future. And there's awareness of the role public health plays in the health of citizens. And again, this ties into what I'll be doing here at Catolica. As both countries have undergone healthcare system reforms, this has been intended to address disparities in healthcare and healthcare access, increase healthcare access, as well as improve health outcomes. And those are health outcomes not only for individual patients, but for populations. So when we think about public health, we're really talking about population health, so the health of groups. In Chile and the U.S., there's been an opportunity for nurses and the nursing profession to improve the delivery of care and play an important role in leading healthcare. An interesting fact that I didn't include in the slides is, you know, there's also a nursing shortage in the U.S. and one here in Chile. We know that there's just about nine nurses for every 1,000 people in the U.S. And here in Chile, it's less than one nurse per every 1,000 persons here. So quite a shortage. I mean, the fact that the U.S. is experiencing a shortage, and then you compare that to what's currently the status here in the U.S., in Chile, you can see the urgent need to prepare nurses not only for bedside, but also looking at scholarship and the development of research, because that's where, when we think about improving patient outcomes, that's where we get our data that we need to make changes and improve interventions. And those statistics came from the World Health Organization from 2015. So more than ever, this requires collaboration. Collaboration on care issues and figure out the best ways to provide patient care, particularly when we know we have shortages not only of nurses, but also perhaps faculty. So innovation and collaboration are needed and across and within disciplines. So that's kind of where the background of my Fulbright application, where it's sourced. So why Catolica? Boston College and Catolica are both Catholic universities, so we share mission and values. So that was something that was important to me when I was looking at universities and places where I could apply for the Fulbright. There's an excellent reputation of the nursing school here. Boston College also has an excellent reputation for preparing future nurses as well as doing research. There are shared research interests between faculties of the two universities. So to my right here, who just joined us, is Dr. Lillian Cravada. So she is at Catolica, and she's also my primary mentor and collaborator while I'm here. So there were shared interests. Her work, she does a lot of work with HIV and HIV risk, and that overlaps well with my interests. There was also an existing relationship. So before this point, we were doing exchanges with students. So Boston College would come here for a period of time, students, and vice versa. So it just seemed like it's one of those things, like many things came together, it's a good fit. So what are the goals of my Fulbright? So spend active, engaged time as an ambassador to faculty and students, and part of that is just being present. I sometimes, I'm a big believer in you know, kind of having the open door policy and just being seen and around and be able to be available for conversation. Work to establish connections that are beneficial to both students and colleagues, and then to promote educational research and teaching pathways. And I'll talk a little bit more about these specific, these overarching goals, what my specific objectives are. So specific projects. One of the first ones is develop and co-teach a course with Lillian, a public health course at the master's level. And again, that's why in the beginning I shared a little bit more about myself. I'm a public health nurse. I've done a lot of community work. I've taught public health at Boston College. Dr. Farrar's expertise is in public, her PhD is in public health sciences. So together, we make a good team to be able to teach a public health course at the master's level. Another project that I'm going to undertake or currently working on is a writing workshop of tips for publication. That was something that was, you know, this is where collaboration comes in. What do I have some expertise in, and what do you need, right? And so this was something that in preparation we had determined was something the faculty were interested in. It was something that I certainly feel comfortable doing. And so the goal is two sessions. We've already got those scheduled, and to work with faculty and graduate students. So essentially, to kind of lead them through writing publications, do some tips, but then also provide the kind of the mentoring along the way. So we'll do two workshops at the beginning of the academic year here, and then I will meet individually with faculty over the course of the semester to kind of move people along. Because as we all know, you know, sometimes it's difficult to sit down and write, and if you have working with folks and able to have some guidelines and some guidance, often you have really great outcomes. So mentoring faculty and graduate students. I'm also, goal is to work with a master's thesis student. So I have several databases from my work that I brought with me, and to be able to work with a master's student in terms of looking at some data analysis, working on their theses. So I have already scheduled an appointment with the master's thesis kind of program director, and will be introduced to the class and talk about my projects and databases and figure out where we can have a good fit. Because ideally, you know, it would be nice to work with a student who's interested in my databases and not just, you know, like, oh, okay, great, Dr. Sutherland. Another project, which we're already working on now, is a preliminary research study. So, and this research study is going to focus on, so my grant that I just finished up in November focused on college women, specifically college women and their experiences of intimate partner violence, and whether healthcare providers were screening or assessing for intimate partner violence. Because what we find is, in this area of research, is that women are engaged or have numerous contacts with the healthcare system in which there are opportunities for healthcare providers to ask about intimate partner violence. And what we find in college age students, which who are a very at-risk population for intimate partner as well as sexual assault, that healthcare providers are not asking about violence. So that was what my grant that just finished focused on. So I share that because my work, I have done a lot of work with college students. And so for this research study, we're going to focus on health behaviors among college students, looking at sleep, experiences of intimate partner violence, just escaped me. Oh, eating habits and drinking. So, yes. This is why people work in teams, right? So we're working on smoking and drinking. Yes, thank you, yes. So we're working on the Institutional Review Board, the human subjects proposal right now. Goal will be to collect the data and get a collaborative publication out during the time of my Fulbright, with the idea that publishing together, then we'll be able to forward work on more collaborative work together, and perhaps even apply for a National Institute of Health grant. They, as many of you know, NIH is very much into teams, and if your co-PIs, have you published before? What has your work relationships been together? So, and then finally, Dr. Ferrara has a database that of a study that she finished a couple years ago that was funded by the National Institutes of Health, and we're going to do a collaborative publication on that. So, just a couple acknowledgments. Thank you to Lillian for being here today, but also being my mentor through the Fulbright. The students and faculty at Católica, I have to say, have been there a whole week and a half, but people have been so welcoming. Yesterday I went to a faculty meeting, and out of that came the very strong interest in advanced practice nursing and what that looks like in the U.S. and what my experiences have been as a family nurse practitioner. So we're already planning another presentation of some sort to the faculty, talking about what does advanced practice look like in the U.S. and how could that perhaps translate or be look here in Chile. And then finally, just my colleagues at BC, as well as my dean, is obviously I'm here for a semester. I'm not teaching at Boston College, and I know that a lot of people make sacrifices, so a person like myself can come here and have this rich experience and develop collaborations. So, thank you very much.
Are your classes in English or Spanish?
English. It would not be, I would worry about my students because my Spanish is, Lillian obviously can, but we're going to teach in class.
And they'll be particularly also like writing, but related to nursing, right?
Yes.
Yeah. So that would be a great thing for you guys to link up with Gracia, who is an academic writing center person at Universidad Católica. So she can maybe participate in some of these and also kind of help a multiplier effect. And will any of these be recorded or streamed later on for thinking of other writing centers in here? No, is that not something that hasn't been thought of?
I don't think we've thought of that. Okay. About that.
No. That's
really good. Yeah, I appreciate
let
that.
Us know.
There's a lot of interest generated in being able to help people write.
Yes, it's a skill that lacks here.
Mm-hmm. You'll find that out very quickly. And the Writing Center person is also a former Fulbrighter, so it'd be really nice if you could, hook up with her and do something.
Actually, she has supported some people some of our.
Yeah, she did.
I'm not sure if the master's students, but the faculty.
Because although it's in at the Católica, it's open to everyone, just so that you know. Mm-hmm. So anyone can walk in and say, I need help, and I want it in your lecture or whatever, and it's free.
So for that, I go through Education USA?
You can get her contact from
any of
us.
Yeah.
So, yeah.
That's a great idea.
Yes, Mason.
Yes, so you mentioned that whenever women have contact with the health system, you say they weren't being screened for sexual violence?
In the U.S., we have specific recommendations from the U.S. Preventative Task Force that speaks to when there's an interaction with a provider, that providers, and that's loosely defined, but definitely includes nurse practitioners, PAs, RNs, and physicians, need to be assessing for violence.
Okay, well, that was part of my question.
Yeah.
Was the categorization of the health providers, for example, like a gynecologist would be like, here are some resources so you learn about this, before, as well as in the moment screening. So I guess my question is, where do you see the biggest weaknesses, and where do you see the biggest strengths?
Mm-hmm. Well, the group you mentioned, OBGYNs, are actually the best providers in terms, I don't mean the best, but they report the highest rates of screening for intimate partner violence, particularly when a woman's coming in for prenatal. We're very good at doing that. I think, what was interesting with my, I would say so, OBGYNs, and then, other ERs, emergency rooms, often do a really, positive job in terms of screening for violence. I was focused on college women because of one, we know attention to sexual assault as well as intimate partner violence among this population, and many, you know, in the U.S., many college students use student health. They go on campus, and so that was the focus of the grant and the work, was to look at were healthcare providers in college health centers, where many college women receive care, were they discussing or screening for violence? So I have two papers right now that are under review that are about those results. So.
That would be interesting here. I mean, because here it's very specialized. So if you know, you don't always have like the student health center or the person where you can go, where you know you would probably as an 18-year-old girl would be a little more shy to go to a OBGYN rather than to just kind of go to the health center and kind of go for you know something else and then I don't know. So that would be also be interesting to see how so many. I find that there's less layers here in a way where you might open up, but to a nurse or someone else that you may feel more comfortable with, or that may be asking those questions rather than some guy who's saying, relax, now come a little further. Hey, okay, by the way,
yeah.
You know,
yeah,
it's already intimidating as it is for many people that was the first time going to a OBGYN too.
Right. And the literature has really shown that women are more likely to disclose after they've been asked several times by a healthcare provider, or because you know there's that trust thing, you know, and so you know I've seen this, you know, as a nurse practitioner, I've met this patient 5 times, but it's the 5th time that I ask her about her relationships and what's going on that she's like, oh yeah, Melissa, you know, let me, yeah, actually, you know, but it's taken time to establish trust and rapport. You know, and how we measure that, you know, I mean, that's a whole other kind of area of research is how we measure how that happens and why it happens quicker for one person and not so much. And you know, I personally believe that there's a lot of, and we also know this, there's some research done on this that, you know, the characteristics of the provider, you know, and so what are those characteristics? You know, I mean, as a provider, I've had experiences with patients where I click like this, you know, we make a connection. And there have been other patients who I see for a year and I still don't feel, and what is that, you know, and how can we measure that? And, you know, and can we change that, you know, because that would be.
The other thing that's, well, it's such a cultural difference is, you know, the idea of sexual assault, right?
Mm-hmm.
In the States, it's very clear what the, or I don't know, it's not always very clear actually what the limits are, but here it is a very much the society. And I think that the limits are very gray. You know, the areas are very gray. But I do know La Católica, for example, was one of the first universities. They have like a sexual assault policy for the university now, don't
they?
And that was a few years ago that it was created. Before that, there wasn't a policy where students, either student to student or even professor to student, if the student felt that they
that
were being assaulted. That just happened in the last few years. So that's already a huge step, and that was, Catalonia was first in the country. So, got a lot of work to do, but steps are being
made. I have a question. There's a public hospital, and there are a lot of clinics, as I see. Do the doctors get reimbursed by the procedures they conduct in the public health system too, or no?
I would have to turn to my colleague to answer. Yeah, I don't know. I honestly, the question in terms of reimbursement here.
Yeah, do they get reimbursed for the procedures?
Reimbursed by who?
Like in the U.S., the insurance reimburses for the procedures you carry out.
But
is it the same here?
Because we have a mixed system, and within the private area, physicians get reimbursed by type of insurance the person has. On the other hand, we have the public system, and in the public system, usually how it works is that physicians get a contract and they get a salary, a fixed salary most of the time. And sometimes certain physicians, not all of them, has a contract with ONASA, which is our national public health care system, and they provide certain procedures and they do certain things for some patients. We have 4 different types of patients, letter A, B, C, and D. So for C and D, sometimes they provide some type of care for them. And
so
they
don't provide this kind of preventive care that she's talking about, building trust, making sure, you know.
Well, they are supposed to do it in the public
system,
but most of the time they don't do it. And I think that particularly in the community clinics, which are the door for entering the public system, and most of the time it's in charge of nurses and midwives, actually.
That dudes. A discussion of, you know.
A little bit more than physicians.
Mm-hmm.
They still don't do it.
And is HIV a growing issue? Because normally HIV, I thought, was shrinking.
It's not shrinking. It's an incipient epidemic, though. So we have been able to actually keep it in the same incidence for years. The only thing, and something that worries right now, is the fact that a lot of older women are getting newly infected at later ages. And the other thing is that we are getting very young people getting infected. So actually, the trends have changed over the past years.
And the cocktail of drugs is very expensive. So is the public system providing that?
Yes, but not only the public system. I mean, we have a national law, and actually it's the only law related to a health problem in our country, where they say that the government is responsible for providing treatment and heart therapy mainly, and also they are supposed to provide free diagnosis and free lab tests for controlling like viral loads and CD4 count.
So the cost of healthcare must be going up. The cost of healthcare shooting up.
Healthcare.
The national budget in the U.S.
Yeah.
That's a big issue.
Yeah, well, but I mean, it has been growing because of different things, not only HIV. I mean, heart therapy has been part of it for a long time. And as I said, I mean, the numbers actually remain the same. The thing is that the trend has been a little bit different. So something that it's really worrying us right now also is the fact that we are getting a lot of immigrants from places where HIV is bigger than here. And so, for example, I work for a foundation where we take care of kids living with HIV, and most of the new cases, like newborns that we are getting there, they come from Haitian families or Peruvian families, for example. And then it becomes a problem because some of them don't have health insurance here, and they, or maybe we're going to cover everything for the babies, but then what happens with the parents? So, not solved yet.
Yeah. And the real unfortunate part about, you know, an infant being born with HIV or diagnosed with HIV is that we've had for quite some time now a good protocol that can prevent the transmission of HIV from mother to infant. And so, you know, the fact that we still have infant cases, newborn cases of HIV is a travesty.
What is the rate now, like if a mother had HIV, what are the, and they receive treatment, what are the probabilities of the baby being born with HIV?
It's supposed to be reported
in zero.
Wow.
Yeah.
The problem is that, for example, with, and you mentioned something that is really critical, I would say, particularly in this problem, and with intimate partner violence and things that has to do with like cultural factor, is the fact that, for example, some of these babies, some of these pregnant mothers receive treatment, but then afterwards they breastfeed their babies. And then, so it's a different thing. So they are not born maybe.
Mm-hmm. And then they might get transmitted
and
get right through breastfeeding.
Fascinating.
Thanks so much.